Okay, we're back with puzzle number 6, I believe. I just did the train earlier today, and it went pretty smoothly, so I'm going to go ahead and do another one. But I'm thinking I'm going to do the deer, the smaller puzzle. The last one took about 4 hours. I don't feel like sitting here for another 4 hours, so hopefully the deer will go quickly. I think the last 300 piece took an hour and 45 minutes or so. So hopefully that's what we'll get this time. Try to find the deer. Deer. The grass might be a little bit of a pain, but it's pretty small. We'll see what happens. All right, pieces are bigger too.
Is it resolved?
Yes, so let me just pull up the thing so I have it right here. Yeah, I didn't actually write this, I copy-pasted from some of the PDFs, which I will put in the show notes. But yes, the United States Copyright Office issued a clarification to their rules about copyright that resolves this monkey copyright situation. And the bottom line of the story is that they say the photographer does not own the copyright.
Because the monkey pressed the button.
The monkey pressed the button, and so there is no copyright, is there? And sadly, the monkey does not own the copyright. If the photographer didn't get it, I really wish the monkey got it. But no, it's just in the public domain, which is more useful, but way less funny. So that is their thing. When I was looking this up a little bit, there's two things I came across. One, of course, Wikipedia has a page on everything, like there's a subreddit for everything. And they have a whole section on animal-made art, which is kind of interesting to peruse through.
I once bought a painting by a dolphin for my sister when she went through a dolphin phase in Albert SeaWorld. Awesome. I bought her a dolphin painting. And yeah, a photo of the dolphin painting and everything.
Yeah. They have a section on there which is, I just love this section title called Painting Pachyderms. Like, come on, you could have called that painting elephants, but it's so much more fun to call it painting pachyderms. There is a whole little section here which I love on the Wikipedia page, which says, monkey paintings were exhibited in many modern art museums during the early 1960s as fad. However, the cultural and scientific interest in monkey painting has diminished, and a little note is taken of it today, which is a shame for all of those monkey painters.
They had their moment.
They had their day in the sun.
Yeah.
But the thing that I thought was really interesting from the
60s was good for monkeys. That was more the 50s, wasn't it? They were going into space and all sorts. Like,
I don't think going into the space was good for the monkeys. Those monkeys didn't come back.
No, they did. Do you know? Have you?
Oh no! I know what I've done.
The first monkey in space was Ham, but the second one was a monkey called Enos. And he had the nickname of Enos the Penis, mm-hmm. because he had a really bad habit of touching himself in a friendly way. And he would always do it at really inopportune moments, like there'd be like a press conference and all the media would be there to see the monkey that was going into space, and they'd bring him out and show the capsule. And then with all the photographers there, he'd just start doing his thing. So he was like a real character. So there was Ham, Enos the Penis, the monkeys. It was a good time to be a monkey. They were like astronauts, celebrities, astronauts, painters. Wow, that was a real
No, it was a good time to be maybe one of five monkeys on the face of the earth. It wasn't a good time to be a monkey in general. It's like there's a kind of monkey renaissance occurring. It's like a couple of monkeys happen to be celebrities. The end. And most monkeys are still living in the jungle. Or a zoo. So,
well, that's nice too. Well, zoos, mate, not so much zoos, but I reckon I sometimes envy animals that like a stress. I'm gonna start this.
Really?
No. What? They've got a nice, they just don't have to worry.
This is the Disney version of what it's like to be an animal. What was I wish I could remember off the top of my head what book this was. I was reading some book which was talking about studying monkeys and pointing out that in theory chimpanzees should have a really sweet life because they're pretty rarely hunted. They're basically like apex predators. They're relatively strong. Their food sources are relatively abundant, and isn't that great for monkeys? They can sit around and, you know, eat bananas in the sunshine all day if they want to. But the thing that most monkeys like to do with their time is torment other monkeys and play social dominance games. And so it's not actually some kind of relaxing, let's hang out life being a monkey in the forest. Like, you're constantly worried that the chief monkey is going to beat you up, or there's going to be a monkey coup. It's not a chilled existence.
No, yeah, well, neither's being a human. But how's that different to being a human?
Unlike a monkey in the forest, I can go off to York and just do nothing for a few days. You can fly to Morocco. Right, where's the monkey going to go? Nowhere. That's no good for monkeys.
I do have to say, in agreement with you, I did, a while ago now, I went on a safari. Now, a safari, and it was a really good one, Masai Mara. It was brilliant, and it was during the migration, so it was like the best time to go. And there were two things that struck me about it. One was how much more stuff you see than you expect. Like, I thought you'd get in like a four-wheel drive and drive along a dusty road for 2 hours, and then everyone would get excited and go, oh, look, in the distance, there's a lion, and you would look at it for a few minutes and think, wow, what a thrill that was.
That's my mental image of a safari.
It was nothing like that.
Huh.
You were out on a big grassy plain most of the time, and it was just wall-to-wall animals, and everywhere you looked, something amazing is happening. And there are about 20 or so four-wheel drives around, all, you know, going off and doing their own thing. And if a whole bunch drive in one direction, you know something really good's happening, so then everyone goes that way. But there are so many animals, you can almost run over animals like that you didn't see sitting in the grass. And there is at any given time, 20 or 30 stories happening, unfolding, of like life and death.
Oh, you mean they're not singing Hakuna Matata all the time?
No.
Just chilling, because it's awesome to be an animal?
Yeah, and I did think the whole time, gosh, you know, it really was very base. Like, it really made me, you know, everything was just about eating and not dying.
Yeah.
And it was pretty amazing.
Yeah, that's what nature is. That's why we left. We built this nice city, and now I don't have to worry about a tiger eating me.
I'd still rather be trying to outrun a tiger than have to go to that museum in York.
Now I want to go. You're making it sound so interesting. If I'm ever back in York, I have to go now.
All right.
Wait, no, don't try to move us on, because I have one final thing about the monkey copyright, which I like here. So I was looking
for... Yeah, there's no hurry. There's no hurry, mate. We're flying through it here. We've been recording 50 minutes, and we're on our first item of follow-up.
Are you serious? Oh, God. We had so many things planned for this show. There was one little detail which was not mentioned in most of the monkey copyright stories that I saw, which I think is great. I copy-pasted it here. Just talking about the U.S. Copyright Office. It says, the office will not register works produced by nature, animals, or plants, which seems reasonable. I also like this part here, which is, huh, the office will not register a work purportedly created by divine or supernatural beings.
Mm-hmm.
I just love that somebody at the copyright office is like, we got to think of everything while we're clarifying these rules. Let's make this as clear as possible. And I love that they have pre-built in there an exception, which is for divine or supernatural beings can also not register their works with the copyright office of the United States government. U.S. government says no.
So if you get like Jesus on a piece of toast or something.
Yes, that is exactly the example that they used. Is
right.
Like that kind of thing is not copyrightable. You, the person who has the toast that Jesus spoke to, you can't own the copyright that is in the public domain, all of God's works. Although the interesting thing is they have a little caveat to that, which is that work which is inspired by a divine or supernatural being, but created by a human, can be copyrightable.
So your videos are safe then?
Yes, that's exactly it. An angel whispers into my ear the sweet scripts every time.
So, in the last podcast, we talked at length about your videos and the robot stuff, and self-driving cars were a big part of it. And in your video, and you were kind of advocating using the term auto for self-driving cars, and that got quite a lot of reaction from people on, you know, on Reddit and that. And a lot of people, while perhaps not disagreeing with your message, don't think auto should be the word used for self-driving cars, because auto is already used for normal cars in many countries.
Every single German in the world tweeted to me or emailed to me to helpfully let me know that auto already means car in German. And as I tried to be polite and explain on Twitter, you're speaking German. You have words for all kinds of stuff. It's up to you Germans to decide what is going to be the word for self-driving car in German. Whatever we select in English, it shouldn't matter, right? This is not relevant to the German language that we use, that I think auto is a great word for self-driving cars. Make up a new word. You know, I don't know what's going to work in Germany, but I'm sure it's
that's
going to be incredible.
It's a little insensitive. It's a little insensitive of you, because, I mean, I agree that languages are different and you can't pander to everything. But there's got to be a bit of give and take here. Like, if you came up with a word for something, and in a few big famous languages, that was the word for murder or, you know, rape or something, you would have second thoughts, wouldn't you?
Okay.
Well, hang on.
Yes. Brady, I will grant you that if auto meant rape mobile in Germany, then maybe it should be something we should reconsider using. But it doesn't. It means car. And I think that kind of linguistic conflict, I'm totally uninterested in.
But that linguistic conflict is even closer. Like, it could cause even more problems. Because if it was the word for rape mobile, people would be like, well, okay, that's ridiculous. But, like, if it's so close to car already, and in fairness to Germany, they're pretty good at making cars. It's not like they're dissociated from the world of automobile manufacturing. They're pretty much near the top of the tree here. So surely we should be listening to them and being aware of potential problems down the track here.
I think not when considering what word works best in the English language. If languages are their own things, and you run into these linguistic conflicts all the time. I think I'm sure everyone's heard these like hilarious stories of brands that pick some word that they try to use as their thing, and then it turns out that it does mean something horrible in Japanese or in Spanish. So, like, linguistic conflicts happen all the time, because the number of sounds that the human mouth can make comfortably is relatively small. It's not infinite. So there's always going to be a conflict. But I feel like it's not my job to pick a word that works well in every language all across the world, because other people are speaking other languages. There are other things that can be used in those languages to describe the same things. Like, that's what we do now. That's what languages are. If Germans, for example, said for some reason that they think car in German is the perfect word for a self-driving car, I'd be like, great. If that works in German, perfect. Run with it. Because these are separate languages. You don't have to worry about this kind of overlap. I'm still 100% behind auto as a word for a self-driving car in the English language. And other languages should pick other things for their... Like, the whole reason I like auto is because it's an automobile. This is an entirely English-based pick. But I have no idea what kind of thing would work well or sound good in other languages. So those languages should pick their own things.
Okay.
Sometimes I have a hard time telling if you are serious or not serious when you ask questions. And this is one of these times. I'm not sure if you were serious when you brought that up.
I think I mean, you know, I'm always the devil's advocate. And you are
the best devil's advocate there could possibly
be. I think saying I'm the devil's advocate actually seems to rile people up, so I won't say I'm being the devil's advocate. What I'd like to do is ask questions that will make you explain your position in a new way that will help me understand it better.
Yes.
So whatever you want to call that, I do that sometimes. But I do think if a country that makes a lot of cars calls
their production of cars is irrelevant to this conversation. It doesn't matter how many cars they make.
Well,
I don't see that how that has any bearing on this at all.
Well, I think it could, because if they were to then become a leading producer of self-driving cars, like, they're probably going to start getting involved in naming these things, and then these things are going to
but no company calls their thing a generic name. Like, Honda doesn't come out with the 2007 Honda car, right? They come out with a particular name for a thing. I'm talking about what is the name for the generic category of things in a particular language. So, of course,
you don't see any potential for problem here.
Is that what you're saying? Yeah. What is the problem? I don't understand what problem there is.
If the biggest economy in all of Europe calls cars autos, and then the big language, English, decides they're going to call this new category of vehicles autos, you see no problem ever for confusion and...
Your theoretical example for confusion requires that two people are speaking at each other using different languages. Presumably, things are entirely consistent if you're both speaking German, you both know what you're talking about, or if you're both speaking English, you both know what you're talking about. Like, what is the confusion here? Someone in English is overhearing someone in German speak about something, and they pick out one word and then place an order for 1,000 autos based on overhearing a conversation in another language? Play out for me the scenario where this matters.
I just think if we're at the start...
When is this going to be confusing? I want an example.
Well, see, what happens, right, is people who speak German sometimes leave Germany, and people who speak English sometimes go into Germany, and sometimes they try to speak to each other in each other's languages.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes when someone is referring to one kind of car, the other person might think they're referring to another type of car. Now, I think it's pretty unlikely they're going to order 1,000 of them without this confusion being resolved. But I do think if we're at the start of the process and deciding what the word should be, and there is no word yet, then maybe we should take this opportunity to consider all of our options and remove the confusions before they happen.
I'm still not sold on this. I
can tell.
This is like the world's most unconvincing argument to me. Okay, so somebody is in a car rental store in Germany, and they are trying to speak German because they are being a polite tourist with the person at the car rental company, and they accidentally rent the wrong kind of car, which will be immediately apparent when they go to the lot to get it, and then disaster?
Say a new number was discovered, right, by a mathematician. Like, you know, like Graham's number. Some new constant was found, some new number. Like, obviously, the number already exists, but a number has to be named for some reason.
Yeah.
Would you call it, sept, S-E-P-T, the French number for 7? Would you call it that? Or would a mathematician think, actually, even though no English person calls 7 that number, French people do? So instead of calling it that, I'm going to call it something else, just so we don't cause confusion for the French mathematicians. I'm not going to say, stuff the French, that's their problem, I speak English. I'm going to be a little bit considerate to my fellow humans on Earth who I acknowledge have their own language, And rather than using a word that will cause a potential conflict or confusion, I'm going to call the number something else. I'm going to use another permutation of letters that doesn't already represent a number in another language. And I'm going to call my new number a Google Wiggle Whack. Because that word doesn't exist for it.
Mm-hmm.
But you would be like, stuff them. They speak French. I'm calling it what I want. That it's their problem.
The one difference here, I would say, is that you're talking about coming up with something like out of the clear blue sky that is unrelated to anything else. So you're coming up with an arbitrary name for a brand new thing. And presumably, you as the discoverer want that name to spread. This is much more like the companies coming up with brand name problem, which is why they're willing to spend a whole bunch of money trying to research what a brand name means in every language ever. Because this is like a different case. I still say that the case of what is the generic term for a class of objects in a particular language is a very different case from that, from someone discovering something and wanting that name to spread, and you can choose a totally arbitrary name.
Yeah, I agree. The word you're saying, the word has to do what it says on the tin.
Yeah.
You can't choose from an infinite number of letters. I understand that.
Here's the thing. If I'm trying to push, because I think self-driving car is just an awful mouthful.
Yeah, it's
right?
A mouthful. Yeah.
It's a terrible mouthful. I mean, honestly, if I have to sit here and predict what are we going to call self-driving cars in 10 years, I predict that we call them cars and that people just stop making a distinction between the self-driving variety and the non-self-driving variety. I think this is the same thing like with smartphones. Like, well, guess what? In 5 years, they're just phones, right? The whole need to have this additional category becomes rendered irrelevant. That's my actual prediction for what would happen.
Yeah.
But like, instead, if I in my video said, oh, we shouldn't call them cars because it limits your thinking about them, which I still think is true and why I still think we do need a different word, and I said, let's call them flubberty gidgets instead. Like, it's just so stupid, right? Like, maybe flubberty gidget is not anything in any other language. But that is not I'm trying to pick a word that can spread easily and is reasonable in the language that I speak. If anything has a chance of competing with car, auto is it. And so like that's again why I think it's a different scenario talking about coming up with a new number versus coming up with a category for a thing in a language. So that's why I think they're different.
Okay.
Are you convinced? I don't think you are.
No, I still have a few more things I could say to that, but I think we've probably exhausted.
We have probably left it. However, for people who are still listening who haven't left, there's one final thing that I want to say.
I'm not sure even I'm in that category.
I swear I will edit this down. Somebody edited the Wikipedia page about self-driving cars so that for two glorious days it said self-driving cars, also known as, and they have a list of a couple of things, and somebody snuck onto the end of that, autos, and it stayed up for longer than these things usually do, because Wikipedia is really good about catching this kind of stuff. It was up there, it was glorious, but here's the thing, people. I don't want you to go back to that page, like happened with the Brady typing page, and constantly try to revert it and get into a big war and then get blocked. I don't want that at all. What I want is for people to actually use the word auto in blog posts that they write or anything that they create for the internet, because that is how you convince Wikipedia to actually change something. You need evidence of its widespread use, not just, oh, one dude in a video said it should be called this thing. So don't edit the Wikipedia page to say autos. Just actually use the word if you are publishing something on the internet. That is my request. Let's make this happen, people. There we go. So that's the end of that.
What about Flubberty Gidget? I think that's a good name.
Yeah, doodle-doot. I'm going to cut right there.
I do have one more thing to add to this discussion, which I didn't bring up last time.
Okay.
I actually, one of my best mates is a pilot, a passenger aircraft pilot.
Mm-hmm.
And he flies 747s. And for many, many years, I have been telling him that I... Because the big joke I always have with him is that he's not really necessary and everything's automated and they land on their own and take off and everything's autopilot. And I have always said to him that I think we will have pilotless planes
mm-hmm.
at some point. And the argument, and the thing I've never been sure about is whether or not it will happen in our lifetime, so I'll be able to sort of, you know, claim victory. He's convinced it will not happen. I think it will happen. Will it happen in my lifetime is the question I want the answer from you.
I would say that in your lifetime is a long enough time frame that I would give that better than even odds.
Yeah.
But I would not expect that to be soon. I tried to look into the plane automation thing. It was a little hard to get the details that I wanted, but if I had to make a prediction, I would easily bet on autos being fairly widespread in society before there's any serious talk about planes
yeah.
with nobody in the cockpit. You know, that would be my guess. So maybe
I wonder if the podcast will still be going. We could have the first ever plane crash corner talking about the crash of a pilotless plane.
Oh, won't that be exciting for you
mm.
and you alone? Hello, Internet. This episode is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create your own professional website, portfolio, or online store. Squarespace has been around for 10 years, and they're constantly improving their platform with new features, new designs, and even better support. And they have beautiful designs for you to start with, and they have a ton of style options. You can create a unique website for you or your business. They released 20 new customizable templates this past year, and every design automatically includes a mobile experience that matches the overall style of your website, so your content looks great on every device, every time. And Squarespace is easy to use with simple drag-and-drop tools, but if you need help, Squarespace has an amazing support team that works 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And as I've said before, Squarespace is without a doubt my personal recommendation for the best way to make a website. It just could not be easier. If you want to make something on the web, you probably don't want to care a whole lot about learning about servers and HTML and CSS. Like, whatever the thing you want to make the website about is what you want to be spending your time on, not all of the code that's behind the scenes and all that kind of stuff. So, use Squarespace. It is so easy and so powerful. I really do recommend them. So Squarespace is good for everyone, whether you need a simple website solution or you're a developer and want to get into the code. There are so many options, and it starts at just $8 a month and includes a free domain name if you sign up for a year. So start a trial with no credit card required and begin building your website today. And when you decide to sign up for Squarespace, make sure to use the offer code HELLOINTERNET, all one word, to get 10% off and show your support for Hello Internet. Squarespace, everything you need to create an exceptional website.
I was going to make this my paper cut, my Brady's paper cut, but I'm not sure I want to do that because this is controversial.
Mm-hmm.
I want to talk about the Ice Bucket Challenge.
Ooh.
Now, I know you live in a cocoon, and if I tell you anything that's happening in society, you generally don't know what I'm talking about.
This one made it through my bubble, yeah.
Even you know what the Ice Bucket Challenge is.
Yep.
Okay. Can I start by saying, raising money for things is a good idea, and motor neuron disease is bad news.
Mm-hmm.
And the amount of money they have raised for the Ice Bucket Challenge is amazing, and I don't know, I'm not going to get into discussions about charity A and charity B and what percentage they spend on what, which people get in a tizz about. I'm not qualified to talk about that, but the Ice Bucket Challenge is beginning to get a little bit on my nerves, and there's a few things I don't like about it. Is that all right? Am I even allowed to say that?
Well, first of all, for people who might not be aware, give a brief description of it, and then tell me what your problem is with ice.
Well, maybe the problem is I don't fully understand it. But you pour a bucket of ice water over your head after being challenged to do so by someone else, and then you challenge three other people to do it, and you post a video of yourself doing it online. Here's me. Hi, it's Brady here. I've been challenged by Gray. Let's raise money for ALS. Pour it over your head. Scream. Have a laugh. I now challenge three other people, Bill Smith, John Jones, and Sally Johnson, to do likewise, and then they have to do so. And there is an element of make sure you give money to the charity.
Mm-hmm.
And this has obviously become incredibly widespread. And, like, I don't know who came up with this idea, but they are clearly a genius. And this thing has just taken off and raised all this money for a good cause, and it's hard to say you're annoyed by it. But I am annoyed by it, mainly because it's everywhere. And, like, every time I go onto Facebook, there's 100 more of them I have to look at. But also, I don't like this sort of chain lettery component to it. I think that's the main thing I don't like about it, this challenging other people to do it. And then there's incredible peer pressure on the people who've been challenged to do it. Like, I know some people who've been challenged. And then then people start ringing them up and saying, I challenge you to do it. Why haven't you done it yet? You're supposed to do it. And it reminds me of back when I was at school, and there used to be these chain letters that people, it was mainly school girls at the school I went to, would get, and they would have to hand write 10 copies of it and send it to 10 other people, because if they didn't do it, like, their mum would be murdered or something like that. And
I forgot about, like, those. I remember those.
Yeah, that's what it's like. It's got this peer pressure-y chain letter component to it that I don't like. And I also do think it's a bit humble braggy, isn't it? It's a bit look at me about charity. And I don't know, that's why it works, though. You know, it's the reason it's worked is it appeals to people's desire to, I don't know, I read a really good term for it. What was it? It was something like donor-centric philanthropy, where the philanthropy is all about putting the emphasis on the people giving the money. Which is interesting. I don't know, it raises a lot of, there are a few things about it that make me feel uneasy. There are other things about it I think are brilliant. I mean, I've in my BBC days, I had to make a few films about people who were suffering things like motor neuron disease, and there's nothing more terrible. And if they're raising, you know, $100 million for that, it's hard for me to criticise it at all.
Yeah, no, it's...
But there are things about this particular style of campaign that just annoy me a bit. And by the way, I've made a video along these lines. I made a dice bucket challenge on Numberphile, where we poured a bucket of 1,500 dice over someone. We raised the money for WaterAid. This seems to have happened now. People are adapting the charity. We did it for WaterAid for various reasons, but so I am as guilty as it. We didn't do the challenge other people, but you know, I have jumped on the bandwagon, so I am as guilty as anyone. But thoughts?
Yeah, I was just looking at the Wikipedia page about it, because I was trying to find some of the origin of this.
Ah, yeah.
And it looks like this is basically a thing that predates the ALS campaign in particular, that this is, it is not original with them, and that it is unclear where this started, but that the ALS campaign has also decided to do a kind of ice bucket challenge as well. And yes, these things are very hard to talk about, and I saw ALS kill a very close family friend over a number of years when I was growing up, and that disease is awful. It really is. It is one of the most terrible things that can happen to a person. So that, but like, I've seen that stuff up close, and it's very hard to talk about this and separate, like, let's just talk about the mechanics of the thing versus the disease ALS itself, which is awful. So if we're just talking about the mechanics of it, I think I have some of the same feelings that you do, but this is a kind of, I have a very strong, I almost think of it as like the opposite of, I don't know what they're called, but you know, I think I've heard them called like the Chinese finger traps. Do you know what I'm talking about if I say that? I don't know if there's a better one. They're like the rolled up paper things that you put your two index fingers into, and the more you pull, like the tighter grips your fingers. What would you call it?
Yeah. I'd call it that. Those wrapped up paper things you put your finger in.
There you go. I'm sure there's a better name for it, but I think that's what we called it as kids. But
yeah,
I have kind of a reverse feeling of that to a lot of peer pressure stuff, where it's the same challenging aspects of it that I find like a reverse finger trap. Like the more I would be challenged to do something, the more repulsed I would be by the thing, and the more I have this feeling of like, I'm not going to do a thing just because people are telling me to do it. And the more people are telling me to do the thing, the more I guarantee you I'm not going to do it. And that is not specific to this challenge. This is just a thing in my life in general, which, let me tell you, makes me super popular at parties sometimes. Everyone's like, let's do the fun thing. It's like, no, if you're telling me to do the fun thing, I'm not doing it. Come on, everybody's doing it. No, now you're just a huge party pooper. You're no fun and nobody likes you. And it's like, well, fine, but you don't tell me what to do. So that is, I have this same kind of reluctance to it, and I have been following this thing very closely, but I have seen a couple people specifically say, like, I'm doing this thing, but I'm not challenging other people to do it.
Yeah.
So it's interesting to hear you say that your video that's along these lines, you went that same path, which makes me very happy that you did a thing, but then you say, like, I'm not challenging other people to this. But of course, the challenge is exactly what makes it successful. It's this viral spreading
of
it.
Yeah. It would have
gone nowhere fast if it didn't require the challenging as well.
Yeah. And anyone who has done it and raised money for any cause, I think is brilliant. I do think it's great that they've done it. But
raising money is great.
And I don't know. It's probably just the grumpy old man in me. Something you just said then, though. There is a question I want to ask you, and all week I've been thinking I want to ask Ray this question, but there was no excuse to ask you. And it even got to the point where I thought maybe I need to come up with a new segment, which is Brady Asks Gray a Question. And you've kind of touched on it enough for me to now ask you the question.
Uh-oh.
Are you ready for the first ever installment of Brady Asks Gray a Question?
I'm getting nervous now. I don't know if I want this to be a segment. All your segments live on for a very long time.
Here it is.
Uh-huh.
Do you dance?
Do I dance?
Yes.
I guess no, not really.
So if you're at like at a party and stuff, or out with mates and, you know.
Oh God, at a party, no, definitely not. If I'm home by myself and listening to music, I might do motions that might be interpreted by some very generous people as dancing.
Oh, I would love to see that.
No, you wouldn't. It would be like Elaine on Seinfeld. But
I'm trying to think how much money I would pay for a video of you just dancing at home on your own. It is not insubstantial.
Maybe that'll be my next fundraiser.
That could be the ice bucket challenge. How much money do we have to raise for Gray's cause of choice before he will release?
Yeah, but you see, you're already going about this the wrong way. Like, I guarantee you, if I start getting a whole bunch of messages from people on Twitter, like, oh, you have to upload a video of you, like, now it will never happen, people.
No, but what if, like, you know, Bill Gates or someone who, you know, is a listener to the podcast said, Gray, I will donate this sum to the charity of your choice, and like the money's on the table.
I really don't like being told what to do. I really don't like that. I could turn down very, very large sums of money.
It's not you turning it down. You're turning it down for a charity.
No, see, this is all a kind of blackmail stroke.
Thank
terrorism.
You. Thank you. Blackmail is the word. They should call it the ice bucket blackmail.
I'm not sure that's exactly right.
But when they name, but naming people, like naming them on a video and not telling them you're going to do it. Like publicly calling someone out to do something. Okay, blackmail is a really emotive word, and I won't use that word. I'm sorry for using the word blackmail, but publicly calling someone out to do something in a publicly, deliberately, publicly posted video. That's harsh. If the person doesn't want to do it.
Yeah, yeah, and that's why I feel like I'll give you an example of a similar kind of thing, which would take it away from charity. Have you ever been to a Cirque du Soleil show?
Yes, I have, a long time ago.
Okay, so you may remember, but they are big on pulling people out of the audience in a Cirque du Soleil show. And they're always very good for the most part. Like they do interesting things and like it's part of the show. But I often find myself during these segments when they're clearly coming into the audience to grab someone. This isn't like a raise your hand and volunteer. This is a we're going to grab someone kind of thing. I am always sitting there thinking, please do not pick me, because I will be the person who sits here no matter how much the audience boos, and I will not go on stage. It's like, let's make this easy for everybody. You don't want to pick me, because that's not going to be great for you. You just want somebody who gets up on stage after the, you know, because I've actually looked up videos about what happens in Cirque du Soleil, like when someone says no, and it doesn't happen very often.
No.
There's clap, clap, claps, you know, people try to convince, and the person says no. And then, like, the clown does the bigger thing, like, let's clap, clap, clap again, right? You get two claps, but after that, you get boos, right? People get mad if you don't go up after the second claps.
Yeah.
And, like, I will be that person. I'm not going on stage because you're telling me to go on stage.
You say that now, but, and the heat of the moment, do you think, you know, you're a nice guy. I'm sure you wouldn't like being booed.
This is something, okay, so I think you bring up an excellent point because there's lots of scenarios under which I totally agree that it is very difficult for people to predict their future behavior. You imagine future you as current you. Like, it's easy to say that now as I'm sitting in an office, right?
Yeah.
Except the only thing is, when those clowns are going around, I find myself mentally preparing for this. I am getting ready for this in a very particular way.
Do you know what, Gray? Do you know what, mate? They know it too. They look, you will never get picked because these people are professionals and they know it. I used to, one of my jobs when I was a cadet journalist on a newspaper was once a week I had to go out into the street and interview 7 people. I had to ask them a question about the topic of the day. They had to give me a little quote, and then we had to take a photo of their face and say their name and their age. So it would be, you know, should women be allowed to vote? CTP Gray, age 42, from Norwood, says, yes, they should be allowed to vote. You know, of course, you know, we're all human beings. Now, getting people to answer a question for you in the street is reasonably easy. Getting them to tell you their name and age and where they live, a bit harder.
Mm-hmm.
Getting them agreed to have their photo taken and put in the newspaper, harder again.
Mm-hmm.
There are some people who love it and want to do it. There are some people who will not do it. And when I first started doing these vox pops going out into the street, they used to take me forever. They would take me a couple of hours with the photographer, and I'd get rejected, and I'd be trying to talk people into it, and they'd say no. And then over time, as I did it more and more, month after month, and then year after year, I became like a Jedi, and I could look at people from half a mile away and just tell the photographer, they will say yes, they will say no, they will say yes. The guy on the left will do it, the woman on the right won't do it. Those two women will do it, and that man over there won't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And it got to a point where my strike rate was just about 100%.
Mm-hmm.
I would never be rejected, because I would never ask people who would reject me, because I just knew the people and I knew all the signs. And I bet you those clowns at Cirque du Soleil are exactly the same. And they scan the audience and they look at you and they're like, in a million years that guy won't get up. He's the one that will say no. And that's why you will never be picked.
Well, I have never in my life been pulled out of the audience for anything.
Yeah.
And it's funny because my father is the exact opposite. We can never go anywhere. And if they're pulling people out of the audience, my dad gets picked every time.
Why do you think that is?
I have no idea, especially because like we're very similar looking guys according to other people. That's why I was going to ask you if you could pick something. What are some of the big tells for either will or won't agree to have their photograph in the newspaper?
Part of it is just a feeling, and just the way people move and carry themselves, and you know, other parts of it are more obvious. You know, women of a certain age are, you know, they become vanity issues.
Mm-hmm.
How the person looks, you know, you can sort of tell whether they're the sort of person who likes having their picture taken. The picture was always the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Everything else is easy. The picture was the problem.
That nonverbal stuff, that's Cesar Millan skills again, right? It's hard to articulate, but you just sort of, you know it and you learned it, and I think that's really interesting.
I think it's probably also a trait of the sort of people who do the job we do. Like, when you become self-employed and your own boss, you're the sort of person who doesn't like being told what to do by other people. So it's, you know, it doesn't surprise me that you and I are both people like that. We probably don't like being bossed around.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point.
Speaking of vox pops and asking people about the issue of the day,
mm-hmm.
Let me ask you, Mr. Gray, walking down the street, what do you think about this whole Scottish independence thing?
I was getting nervous again, but this is ask me a question section.
I thought that was quite a nice little segue into our next topic.
It was a nice section, but you going into slightly interviewee newspaper Brady mode made me a little nervous.
I'm sorry. Let's talk Scottish independence.
Very easily, over the course of my YouTube career, the number one requested video by a mile has been Scottish independence. And so I have looked into this topic a number of times because just the demand for it is just so huge. And as you may be guessing, since I'm talking about it now and since I haven't made one, I have no intentions to ever make a Scottish independence video. I think when we're recording it, it's in 2 weeks now, I think, or maybe only 10 days shorter. It's coming up soon, anyway.
This is the vote you're talking about.
Yes, the vote for in or out for Scotland as part of the UK.
Yeah.
And so the reason that I'm not making a video about this is that I came to the conclusion that there isn't anything to sort of honestly discuss about this as an issue. I could have made a video that talked about a bunch of stuff, but the conclusion was almost everything about the Scottish referendum that people want to talk about. They want to talk about how is the debt going to be distributed? What's going to happen to military assets? What's going to happen to the North Sea oil? How much North Sea oil is there? Will Scotland's economy be better or worse? All of these questions are totally unknowable, and it seems so if you're starting from that premise that like these objective facts about the future of Scotland are unknowable, there's nothing really much for me to discuss on this topic. And then it suddenly becomes an issue of like, well, I guess this is up to the Scottish people. It's like it very rapidly becomes a it's not really any of my business kind of issue. I'm very interested to see what happens. The polls are not clear at this stage about which way it's going to go, but yeah, it's a funny topic because it has been so highly requested, and I've come to the conclusion that I have so very little to say about it because I don't think that there is much to be said about it. I don't know. Do you have any thoughts?
Yeah, I do have a couple of thoughts. I mean, I've got a couple of really good friends who are Scottish, and they're both Scottish journalists for the BBC, so they're obviously very,
mm-hmm.
very interested in it. One of them was just here last weekend, so I was talking to her quite a lot about it.
Yeah, yeah.
And there is a degree to which people like you and I mean, people like you and I who are expats anyway. But,
yeah, we don't even just live in England. We're not even from this country.
if you count us as English people for the sake of this argument, I think it does kind of affect us,
affecting us is a different issue. Yeah, it'll totally affect us.
But it's not our decision.
Yeah, but it's not our decision.
Yeah, and therefore I'm kind of a bit. I always feel a bit wary about saying too much about it as well, because it's a bit like, who am I to discuss it? But the one thing that does amaze me, and you've touched on it with what you said, was we don't know anything about what's going to happen, or even how the independence is going to work.
Yes.
And because of that, it strikes me as really premature to be voting on it. Like, if I said to you, Gray, I think you and I should collaborate and launch a new YouTube channel, are you in or out? I would imagine you would say to me, well, what's the channel going to be about? How are we going to do it? What's going to happen? How will it work financially? What will the topics be? How will we work together? You'd have a million questions,
mm-hmm.
and then you'd say no at the end.
That's very likely.
Yeah, but like, this is not what's happened here. It strikes me as they're saying, we're going to have the vote, and all the people are sitting around saying, well, what currency are we going to use? How is the military going to work? Will this happen? Will that happen? And everyone's saying, oh, we don't know. We don't know that yet. That'll be thrashed out later. Well, hang on a second. Tell me now before I vote, and because that will affect how I vote.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I don't vote, so it doesn't matter. But I feel quite sorry for the people of Scotland here, because it's... So instead, I guess... I mean, I don't follow it very closely, so maybe I'm wrong, but I imagine what's happening instead is it's becoming very much kind of us and them about, you know, patriotism and Scottish identity and some of these other things that are important but are maybe a bit more nebulous. And no one knows what they're voting on. And I think as an outsider who hasn't been following it, it seems a bit crazy to me.
Yeah, so, okay, you brought up the one thing. I wasn't going to talk about it, but I think you've done a nice little intro into this, which is, yes, if I'm pushed, I do kind of have some thoughts on this.
Right.
And I think that you are exactly right. The lack of detail
is... Did you hear that, everyone? Greg just said that I was right about something.
I've said you're right before. It's not unprecedented. But I think you're exactly... And the lack of detail is so striking that I almost think it's like an intentionally done maneuver.
Yeah.
It reminds me of the vote, which also helped launch my YouTube career, about changing the voting system in the UK. And that whole voting system changeover, are we going to use first past the post? Are we going to use alternative vote? That was so poorly orchestrated that I had suspicions at the time that it was done this way intentionally. And we have found out after the fact that basically it was, because the people in power had no interest in this actually working out. And so it was a similar kind of thing. Like, all of the details were relatively vague and information was just terrible. And there was a lot of confusion that was sown. And that was partly because, like, the powers that be didn't really want this to happen. And the Scottish thing, it's like, I almost wonder if the Scottish Independence Party basically wants this vote to take place and would hope that it is just narrowly defeated, that like they don't actually want it to win. Because I feel the same way, that if I was in charge of the Scottish Independence Party, I would feel like, man, you need to get some of these details down about how stuff is going to work. Because I'm just imagining, if I was a Scottish person, and it was the same thing, that they're saying, we're going to vote for independence. Oh, how is that going to work? We have no idea, don't worry, we'll sort it out later. I'd be like, my general political philosophy, I would say, is that you want to push power down, like have power as close to the source where it is being executed. So I'm generally in favor of more powerful smaller governments than more powerful bigger governments. So in theory, I should be on board with the Scottish independence, but the lack of specificity would make me have to say, I can't vote yes to a contract that I have no idea what the particulars are. Like, that's just that's just insanity. And so that's why, like, I it almost makes me wonder if it's this way on purpose.
I mean, the part of me, initially when you said that, and you sort of suggested, is the independence movement scuppering their own, you know, their own cause, initially I thought, oh, that's crazy, you know, like, people like Alex Salmond, the leader there, has nailed his colours to the mast so strongly, you'd think it would be an embarrassing defeat. But on the other hand, I then thought, well, hang on, say they did lose, at least they could say we fought the good fight and we're Scottish to the core.
Yes.
And that would probably serve them very well in years to come. Even they were the plucky losers, but they fought the good fight, and they've always got Scotland's interests at heart. So I can see that. I can see what you're saying.
I almost wouldn't be the least bit surprised if they do like a little rebranding after the election. Let's say it goes down as a no, that the Scottish Independence Party changes their name to something like the Scotland First Party, or I don't know, something like that.
They're called aren't they called the SNP now?
The Scottish National
the
Party.
Is that, yeah, it's the SNP. Yeah.
Maybe you're right about that. Yeah. So then they don't need to do a rebranding. But it's like, especially because of the way the voting system in Scotland is just vastly better than the way it is in England.
Right.
But like they have a lot less to worry about with a shift in the polls. They wouldn't suffer the same kind of totally crushing defeat that small poll number changes can happen, like in England or in America. Mm-hmm. And so, like, yeah, I almost wonder, like, is it better to stay from their perspective as the like plucky We Heart Scotland party versus the oh crap, we have to rule a country and we didn't figure out any of the details beforehand.
We've got no money or military.
Well, it's not even that, but like just think about it. If you are in charge of the division, do you think this is going to be like a quick Las Vegas 1 hour divorce situation? No. This is going to take years and years to sort out if it actually passes. And it's like, you know, who wants to be in charge of that boring affair? Nobody. So I wouldn't, here's the thing, I wouldn't put, if I had to bet on it, I would not bet that it was intentionally done, but I can just say that it raises my suspicions, and the lack of any kind of specificity makes it almost impossible to make a rational decision in favor of this particular split, even though in general I am in favor of smaller, more local governments than I am in bigger, larger government.
Bigger, larger.
Twitter.
Oh,
you
yes.
You love the old Twitter, and so do I. We're both quite prolific Twitter users, aren't we?
Yes. Twitter last week made a kind of testing the waters announcement where they said they were going to be changing some aspects of the way the timeline in Twitter works. Mm. And just about an hour before we started recording, I saw a headline that Twitter has now officially said that they are going to bring on Facebook-style algorithms to the timeline, which is going to radically change the way Twitter works. So,
well, just anything that's Facebook-inspired is poison, so...
Yeah, so...
Already, yeah.
Just some background for those who might be a little bit less familiar with the way these things work. So on I mean, I'm sure most people know, but on Facebook, basically... Facebook is constantly customizing, when you log in to see what are my friends up to, Facebook is constantly customizing the way that looks. And it's using information about the things you give thumbs up and thumbs down to, or the things that you click on, to predict what are the things that you are most interested in possibly seeing. And that description sounds fine. I mean, Facebook is very popular, obviously, but it very much changes what Facebook is compared to something like Twitter. So when you sign up for Twitter and you follow people, when you log in, your timeline on Twitter is just a reverse chronological order, a list of what people have said. There isn't any prediction to it. There aren't any algorithms that say, you know, oh, you always click on the links that this guy sends. We're going to put his tweets up at the top, and you rarely click on what this person says. We're putting his tweets at the bottom.
Or not even showing you
Yes.
tweets.
Yes, or not even showing them as Facebook can sometimes do. Mm. And just the experience of these two services is so different. I really hate Facebook, and I have disliked them for a number of years, and then in just the past couple years, it's like, man, I thought I hated you guys before, but you've really amped things up to make it just awful. And over that same time, my love for Twitter has just been this exponential rise. Like, I really like Twitter. And I'm not a very social network kind of person. But I think the reason that I like Twitter is because of this structural difference between the two of them. And I am just very, very concerned over the future of this thing that I find a lot of value out of, that I get a lot of value out of. I don't know. I mean, how do you sound like you don't like this, the sound of this change either.
No, I mean, I find it... It just... I'm just really suspicious and about their agenda and why they do it. And at the moment, it just seems like quite a fair playing field. And it's sort of, you know, it all happens there as a stream of consciousness, and it all edits itself. And if people like you, they get rid of you. And if you're using it well, they appreciate you and you win. And if you're using it badly, you get dumped and you don't succeed. And I don't like the idea of... I don't like the idea of happening, what happens on Facebook, happening on Twitter. I feel a bit robbed by Facebook. Well, I feel like there's robbery going on because, sorry, I probably shouldn't use robbery. There'll be some proper word for it that you'll prefer. But like I tweeted about this the other day and it totally came across as a humble brag, and it wasn't meant to be, but I'll take it if it was. But like number five has like, I don't know, 60,000 people on Facebook have mm-hmm. liked it. So they've pressed a button and said, I like number five. I want to know what you're doing. And you know, that's not a massive number, but it's all right. And then whenever I write something on there and I see these statistics for how many people have actually seen it, and it's like, you know, we've delivered this to 6,000 people. And I'm like, and of course they're saying, give us money and we'll give it to even more. I almost feel like it's not that I'm being penalised because I'm no good, and you know the users have not clicked on me for so long that they've just said, well, we're not going to deliver your post anymore. They're deliberately holding it back. They're sandbagging.
Yes.
They're sandbagging it in the hope of getting money out of me. And yes. Actually, you know, yeah, I know this isn't news to anyone. It's not like I've, you know, come down off the mountain with the Ten Commandments and I'm exposing what's going on. But like, I hate that. It seems so wrong to me. And
yeah, well, let me just jump in for a second, because I think this is a function of business pages versus personal pages on Facebook. Because I'm not
yes.
sure if personal well, pages see the same number, but the bottom line is that you and I both have business Facebook pages. So I have a Facebook account, in quotes, that is. It's just called Cray's Blog because I made it so long ago. But it is basically the corporate entity of me. And for a very long time, I posted links on there. And Facebook knows this is not a person. This is representing a business instead.
Yes.
And what started to happen, the timeline of this is that at some point, Facebook started basically charging people who posted things on their business pages that weren't doing very well. And they said, if you give us money, we will put this out on even more people's timelines.
Yeah.
So this is where when individuals log into Facebook, well, part of the algorithm Facebook is using is what stuff do you like the most, but they're also using an algorithm of which companies have paid us the most to appear on the top of your timeline.
So that's like an ad almost.
Yeah, it basically is an ad, and yeah. I don't mind advertising, but there's something about the Facebook model that just feels so disingenuous, right? They're not being honest about it. It's like, oh, you follow this thing, and oh, you happen to see this thing from them, but it's also because they paid. It's not just because you followed it. You already expressed
interest. Yeah, I mean, I can accept Coca-Cola giving them a big wad of cash and me having to see Coca-Cola in my timeline. That's just the reality of the world we live in.
Right.
And you and I do that to our viewers indirectly
right.
with advertising in our videos. But it's a bit different to the people who have like asked to see it, like
right,
people
right.
who have liked you, and you have to like, and now you have to.
Or people who have, say, liked Coca-Cola, they say, I want updates from Coca-Cola, but then even then they're not getting all the updates from Coca-Cola.
Unless, yeah, it's like I've done my grocery shopping and I've got all my food and you know the deal is done, and then as I'm walking out they say, oh, if you actually want to put your groceries in your car, that's going to be another $20.
Yeah,
hang on a second.
Yeah, they're inserting themselves as a middleman. So the interesting thing that came up was Derek of Veritasium has two great videos on all kinds of shenanigans that are going on with Facebook.
Yeah,
I'll put them in the show notes. They're really interesting.
Yeah.
But Derek, I think it's okay for me to say this, Derek contacted me when he was making those videos and he wanted to know some of the numbers from my own Facebook page about like how many people were seeing my posts. And the interesting thing was my posts on Facebook, I was totally unaware of this phenomenon, but because my posts were very popular on Facebook, And so I would, you know, if I don't know how many subscribers I have on there. It's not very many. It's something like 20,000, I think. But it would say something like 18,000 people have seen this out of the 20,000.
Right, so a really high proportion.
Yeah, so super high proportions. So I was not really aware of this until Derek brought it to my attention that this is like, there's a promotion thing. I think I'd seen it once or twice, but it just didn't cross my mind, like, what's really happening here. The thing that I have seen the last few times that I've posted into Facebook is they get you from both ends. Because now when I post, Facebook sends me a message that says, hey, that post of yours was really successful among the first 2,000 of your subscribers that we sent it to. Please pay us money to send it to the rest of your subscribers, because this one is really worth paying for. And so now it's like, it doesn't even matter if people on Facebook are subscribed to your business page. They want to see it. It's a successful post. Right, but Facebook is still saying, like, well, we don't want to let this stuff through.
So they're not even allowing cream to rise to the top.
Yeah, so it's on both ends. On both ends, they get you. Now these are particular problems with, you know, being a business on Facebook, and like those are our particular issues, and it's one of the reasons why I don't have links anywhere to my Facebook business page anymore. I don't want to promote that. I have no interest in anybody following me there, and I always keep debating whether or not I should even keep posting the links there, because, like, I have nothing to gain from this anymore, and Facebook is just awful. But the complaints about businesses aside, or just even for individuals, Facebook deciding on what things that you like and what things that you don't. What makes Twitter so valuable to me is that it always feels like when I log into Twitter, it's like you're stepping into a kind of internet room where people are having interesting conversations, right? The people that you follow, they are just, we're all in this virtual room together now. And it's a forum where it is perfectly okay to listen in on what other people are saying and potentially join into any of these conversations yourself. Mm. Because everything is in order and because it is as it is occurring now, Twitter in my mind really has this feeling of like, it is a place that is filled with people who I am interested in and who I could potentially talk to at any moment. Mm. And you can only have that with this chronological list of postings. And so that is the thing that really worries me about Twitter changing this. It's like, okay, if they start hiding stuff or rearranging stuff, it then very much becomes like Facebook, where you go to Facebook to post a thing and maybe people comment on the thing, but it's a different feeling from, I'm just listening to people talk and maybe I'll participate in those conversations and maybe I won't. And that is why I love Twitter so very much. I don't know. I mean, you are a much heavier Twitter user than I am, as far as I can tell. Like, do you get that same feeling from it, or like, why do you use Twitter?
No, I mean, I've got like a bunch of different Twitter accounts, obviously, because of my multiple personalities on the internet. But I don't know. It's hard for me to answer that. I use it for so many different things. It's, you know, I do use it to follow the news. I do use it to stay in touch with my mates and people I like personally. I do use it to follow, you know, people who I'm just interested in, but, you know, aren't my friends. They're just figures who I enjoy following. I use it for entertainment. You know, I look at aviation pictures and things like that. I use it for so many different things, and I just don't want them to break it. And and they're going to. And they're not. And they're going to do it because they want to make money. You know, this is about money. This isn't about improving the experience, because obviously it's about money. And the next step is the Facebook step. You know, it's going to be getting money out of us or delivering us more stuff we don't want for money. I mean, I can't see why else they're doing it. I don't know. I don't know what I think about it, man. I don't know. I'm not making sense because I'm just... No. I don't know much about it. I've heard other guys talking about it on podcasts, and I haven't read the latest articles, but it's just going to turn to rubbish. I know it. It's going to turn to rubbish, and there'll be another thing that disappoints me like Facebook.
Part of what I've been... My vacation was also a little bit of a test run for something that I'm trying to do this month, which is to cut down a lot of my digital life. Like, I'm very much present on the internet, and I mean, I'm only 4 days into it, but for the month of September, I've been intentionally reducing the volume of just tons of stuff. So I have hardly been on Reddit, and I have almost not been on Twitter and a bunch of other things, sort of like, let's see if I can keep a working environment and kind of extend the boundaries of this vacation internet blackout.
As in not posting or not looking as well?
Not looking as well.
Right.
It's not, it can never be perfect, because it is a weird thing that Reddit is also sort of my job. So I'm trying to figure out the balance here, but just cutting down my connection to the internet quite a lot. And even just a few days into it, the thing that is so obvious to me is that I can cut down lots of things, but Twitter is the hardest one, because Twitter delivers so much value, and because to me, Twitter is, in some ways, it's like this passive socialization. Like, there are plenty of people who I'm interested in following and who I know, and Twitter allows me to just keep up to date with people who I know but I don't see in person. It's like we talked about on one of the previous shows, where if the gap between the last time you talked to someone is too long, it feels like there's this big distance between you, because you can only talk about the big things, you can't talk about little things. And Twitter to me is the greatest way and the easiest way to keep talking about the little things with people I know who are not physically proximate in my life. Now, whereas even something like sending an iMessage to someone I know, that still feels a little intrusive to me sometimes, because you know, I don't know what they're doing, I don't want to just interrupt someone with my random thought. But on Twitter, it's always okay to just message someone. You know, like, they will see it if their client is open, and they won't. And that's why I really like it. And I can see that, man, cutting this out of my life is hard, because I get a lot of real value out of it. And then that's why the Facebook announcements make me think, oh God, there's a big difference between voluntarily reducing the volume of something and then just, oh, we changed it, so this whole thing doesn't work the way you like anymore, and now it's just gone. Like, I would feel a real loss in my life if the way Twitter currently works is not the way that Twitter continues to work. So that's why this announcement really catches my attention and makes me very concerned. This is like, oh, you're messing with the way I interact with my friends. Like, that's a very, very personal thing, Twitter. Not pleased to hear about these announcements, so.
Well, part of me thinks we've got no one to blame but ourselves if our friendships now depend on this device, this system. But it is what it is. You know, we put our eggs into this basket, and, you know, what do we know about them? What do we know about the basket? And now we're complaining that they're messing with our eggs.
Yeah, it's a problem that Twitter is not a decentralized platform. I disagree with you about the friendship thing, because these are people like 20 years ago I would never have called, and you know, and also people I'm not even necessarily friends with, but you can follow people that you are interested in, and occasionally you have little interactions with them, and that's a whole totally different experience. You know, like you can't just overhear what interesting people are talking about all the time. So I fundamentally disagree with your friendships.
Yeah, but they're not your friends, man. No, but like, wasn't it weird when we first spoke today before we started recording, and I was talking about, surprise, surprise, the puppy, and you were like, oh yeah, I wanted to show you something, and you were like, oh yeah, I've already seen that, I knew about that, I saw your tweet, and it's like, oh, well, that's it.
Well, I'm not saying that nobody knows better than me that people you follow on the internet are not your friends. Like, I'm conflating two things here, because that's what Twitter allows you to conflate, two kinds of things, right? There are people you are interested in that you can potentially have interactions with on Twitter in a way that you never could under other circumstances.
Yes, of course.
Like, so that is valuable. And then on the flip side is the four people that I follow on Twitter, I can passively keep up with what's going on in their life.
Yeah.
In a way that is beneficial towards the actual friendship that exists.
Yeah.
Like those are the two different things, but that's why Twitter is really valuable to me for both of those reasons. But like, I am no fool that like, oh, all these people I follow on Twitter are my friends. Like, I would say easily most of the people I follow on Twitter I do not know in real life. The number of people who I know in real life and follow on Twitter is very small. I mean, it's probably, I follow about 100 people. I don't know, I guess it's less than like 10 people I know in real life that I actually follow on Twitter. But yeah, so anyway, that's why it's two different things. I think it's valuable, and I don't want them to mess with it, but they will.
They will.
And that will be sad. So,
yeah,
I'm preparing for that loss.
I hate to bring this up,
yeah,
but there was the homework that we didn't collect last week.
Yeah.
And I've got a feeling we're not going to collect it this week either.
Well, I don't know. Did you watch the episode today?
This is the TV show Black Mirror. So the episode you in particular wanted to talk about was episode 1 of series 2. And for people who are unfamiliar
episode,
with Black Mirror... Episode 1 of series 2. And this isn't like a series. They're all one-off pieces, so it's not like you just... You know, they're all standalone shows. And a funny thing happened with it, actually. Because remember we were going to talk about it last time, and I... said I hadn't watched it, and then you told me off, and but a funny thing happened. Two things happened, actually. First of all, I tried to do the right thing, and I followed the CGP Grey model, and I didn't look up what it was about. I wanted to go into it absolutely clean,
mm-hmm,
because I thought that would be a good idea. So I switched it on, and then a second thing happened, and that's one of the things that most annoys me about watching things with my wife, and that is, within 5 seconds of it starting, I realised I had watched it before, and I knew it very, very well. So having told you I haven't seen it and we can't talk about it, I had seen it. And as soon as it started, I was like, oh yeah, of course, yeah, I know this. I did watch it again, though, to refresh my memory. So I have watched what you wanted me to watch. In fact, I have watched it twice. I must say, just in general terms, and... a lot of people have been realizing this now that we have started mentioning it. What a great show, what a great series it is, the Black Mirror series. They're really good shows, aren't they?
They are very, very good.
Should we talk about this one episode? Should we talk about episode 1 of series 2?
So,
and then maybe...
So now we're in a reverse problem, because I had intended to watch the episodes again, because it's been so long that since I've watched them. And today I watched the episode 2 of season 1.
Okay.
But I ran out of time before our scheduled recording session before I could rewatch episode 1 of season 2.
No, that's okay, because episode 2 of series 1, which
yes,
is called 15 Million Merits, I think.
No, that's episode 2 of season 1.
Yeah.
Sorry, I thought you said reverse.
I probably did. This is what we're going to do. We are going to talk about episode 2 of series 1, which is called 15 Million Merits.
Yes.
That's the one we will talk about. Because I have also watched that one twice.
Okay.
I watched that one a few years ago when it first came out, and then I watched it again a couple of weeks ago. And I think in many ways that is my favourite of them. So I'm very happy to talk about it.
Okay. Okay,
go ahead.
That's perfectly fine, because I'm actually not sure how much I have to say about episode 1 of season 2. But episode 2 of season 1, as far
15
as I'm...
million. Let's call it 15 million.
No, minutes. This is way better. This is way better.
2.1 or 1.2.
Yeah. No, yes, of 1 of 2, it's much better this way. what I was going to say is I think this is just a masterful episode of TV. I just totally loved this episode, and yes, it is by far and away my favorite in the series, and the six episodes are very strong. Two of them are not my favorite, but this one is absolutely great. So yes, we will talk about 15 Million Merits.
Do you want to summarize it, or it's fresher in your mind?
Yeah, let me do the summary.
Okay.
Massive spoiler warnings ahead, people. Seriously, you know, watch the episode. Don't listen to us, you know, now if you haven't seen it. It's really good. Okay, so the opening shot is a guy sleeping on his bed, and all around him are computer screens, and the computer screens wake him up with this fake sunrise, and he sits up, and you realize that he's in a little room that's maybe not much bigger than a prison cell, but all of the sides are screens, and it's presenting to him like a virtual field of view.
Yeah, like every wall is a screen. Everywhere you look is a screen.
Everywhere you look is a screen. The only thing in the room is his bed, and then from out of the wall comes like a little sink and a shower. And you see him getting ready for his day. And then as the shot progresses, he's then in an elevator with some other people going somewhere. And where he goes is into a room where there's maybe 20 people, and they are all sitting on bicycles, pedaling away, with a big video screen in front of each of them.
Like stationary exercise bikes.
Yeah, stationary exercise bikes, sorry.
Yeah.
And so they are pedaling away, and it becomes clear that what they're doing is that as they pedal, they are earning merits, or earning points, within the system that they can see on the screen. Like every 10 rotations gets them one merit, or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And then they can buy stuff on the screen or watch particular episodes of things or turn off advertisements they don't want to watch by paying merits into this virtual system.
It's never actually said, but I think the presumption that most people would have is that this life they live, and I understand why you find it hard to describe, because it almost feels like they're in prison, but they're not in prison. They're just like, this is just the way society works now, is you're locked into this... You're locked into this life of living in these cells and peddling these things. And the feeling is perhaps the peddling is producing electricity for society, perhaps.
Explicitly say that at one point. There is one explicit line where they say that the peddling is powering all of society.
Yeah.
I took note because I thought it was kind of amazing that the main character almost doesn't speak at all throughout the whole episode, and
especially the first like 10-20 minutes he doesn't speak at all.
I timed it, and it takes 15 minutes from the start before he says the first word. And even after that he speaks very rarely. It's only until maybe the last 10 minutes that he's really talking in any way. And so that's why, like, I thought it was a really powerful episode, because it manages to show you this world that is both very clear. Okay, I have these guys are on bikes, there are these computer screens, like I understand what's going on, but it also really limits your view. Like, you don't have any sense of how did he get in here? What's going on in this world? Are there lots of rooms like this? And the episode, as it goes on, does sort of answer some of these questions. There is a later shot where they finally show you that he's in one room of many, many rooms in a gigantic building that all have people on bikes and screens. And another character mentions vaguely that, like, she was in another place before she came here, but she wanted to go to a different place where her sister was. But, like, that is the only information you get about the outside society. You don't really know what's going on. And so the whole thing is they are presenting to you a kind of economy that is based on electricity generation and then also just buying virtual objects. That the life that these people lead is incredibly Spartan. And I have to say, it was very interesting watching it a second time, because there's just a ton of details that you pick up on that you miss the first time round. And one of them is just noticing how there's almost nothing in any of the rooms. Everything is gray, except for the stuff that's on the screen. Like, the only color in their life comes from the computer screen. Every item of clothing, every surface, it is all either like black or dark gray. And there's nothing with color except for those screens. So it's like, even like the visual direction of it is showing you, like, this is the most exciting thing in their life is what's on those screens. And the main character you can feel is kind of resistant to this life, that he is. He is there, but he's kind of reluctantly going along with this. He's constantly paying credits to turn off advertising that he doesn't want to watch.
I mean, I thought, I'm sure this will come out more, but for me, a few different things happened, which I'm sure we'll talk about, but advertising and the way advertising is treated in the show is the most powerful thing about that whole show for me.
Yes.
And it was completely fascinating that they live in a world where there is a real premium and a real value attached to being able to not watch advertising.
Yes.
And you have to pay to turn off these ads. They were quite intrusive ads.
Yes.
And sometimes they were like for, you know, sort of sexual pornographic things. So they were really like, they're distasteful in some ways. And so you would have to pay some of your credits to not watch it. And if
yes.
you didn't have the credits or were unwilling to pay and you just shut your eyes,
yeah,
everything shuts down. Everything shuts down. They have detectors that know you aren't watching. So you have to watch these ads. You have no choice. And they're on all four walls of your bedroom. And it really is really invasive.
I was going to say, it was shot so well because they often showed what this guy's life was like without the ads. And very often he was just sitting in his room and there was nothing but a starscape on the wall. And he's looking into space. And then it's really shocking when all four walls are covered with a screaming ad for pornography. Yeah. And one of the things that I noticed as well, the whole episode is done so well that I thought this has to be on purpose. But every time, it takes him a little while to turn off the ad. This whole society is based on hand gestures for interacting with the technology. And so he has to do this shoo away hand gesture to bring up a dialogue that says, do you want to turn off the ad, yes or no? And he has to do it again, and it says, are you aware that this will cost you credits to turn it off, yes or no? And he's like, he has to shoo it a third time before it finally confirms and turns it off. It's like your whole life is surrounded by the 5-second unskippable ads on YouTube, but they can pop up completely in your field of vision at any moment, and you always have to wait 5 seconds to turn them off. It's very startling, and it's very well done.
But you have to pay to turn them off too,
which is an
even worse kicker.
That's exactly it. Like, you have to pay a dollar every time to turn it off, and you never know when they're going to pop up, and they pop up all the time. So it was just, it was really, really well done. And I would just say that there is, I had to look it up because there, I'm going to get it wrong, but... I'll just mention that because I don't know off the top of my head, but there is an internet writer who I really like. I think he's very good, a guy called David Wong. And he's written a bunch of articles for cracked.com, and he also occasionally appears on their podcast. I love the episodes where he's in. But he has an article that I think talks a lot about this episode in an indirect way. The article, I think, came out before the episode, but he talks about why the future is going to be based on BS, and it's a whole article that is kind of about the economy of selling virtual goods and some of just the crazy stuff that happens as more and more of the economy transitions into digital items. Like, what does it mean to be paying real money for virtual objects? Or the other things that companies do is impose artificial scarcity on digital objects, which is kind of crazy when you think about it. Like, it's a digital object. It can be replicated infinitely.
Yeah.
But we're going to put... a lot of online games do this, where there is a finite number of, you know, a certain kind of sword that will ever exist in that universe. And it's like, well, it's very strange. It's a very interesting article. I would recommend reading it.
Yeah.
I think it's a good companion piece in a way to this episode of TV.
Because in this show, that, you know, one of the things you can spend your merits on is, you know, improving your avatar in this virtual world, you know, buying a hat for your character and things like that. So.
Yes. I thought they did it. There's this other little bit of an aspect to it, which is you feel like everybody is rather separated from each other. And this is strange following up from our conversation from Twitter. You see that when they're not working, people are, again, it's a little bit vague, but it seems like they can't quite leave their rooms, and they all end up interacting with each other with these digital avatars that they cleverly call doppels, which I presume short for doppelganger. And yes, a big thing that they're spending their money on is getting new clothes for their doppel, or, you know, this new hairstyle, or these various objects that the doppel can hold while he interacts with other people. And like that is a perfect example of forcing a kind of scarcity, where if they presumably can't interact with each other outside of work hours, then there is value in the way your doppelganger looks on the screen when he interacts with other people. But it's like a total artificial reality there.
There's one thing about this episode that makes me... it doesn't make me surprised you like it, but it made me think you wouldn't like this episode as much as some of the others. And that is, while all of this is going on, and it's all brilliant, and I can see why it really appeals to you as a YouTuber with an interest in advertising and the future and stuff like that, the other big thread of this story and kind of the escape from this world that you can get is that you can go onto this talent show, this show which is like the X Factor, and that's your big escape. And various things happen. I don't know how much we're going to talk about those, but it's a very big part of the show.
Mm-hmm.
And I imagined, from what I know of you, you don't watch a lot of shows like The X Factor and these sort of talent shows. And
no.
there's a lot of things in the show, in Black Mirror, that I thought were really clever, not just in parodying the show, but clever comments on those types of shows, like X Factor and that. And I would have imagined they would be, you would be indifferent to them, or they would be lost on you. Did you appreciate that aspect of the show, or was that kind of not as interesting to you?
I wouldn't be surprised if there were a lot of in-jokes on that I didn't get, or references that are sort of over my head. But I think even, you can watch the show, and if you knew nothing about online talent shows, you could still derive enjoyment from those segments because it still just fits entirely within the world.
Mm.
So the way it works in the story is that people can earn 15 million merits and they can buy a ticket to go on this talent show. And this talent show is promoted all the time through the advertising, and the people who have won the talent show are also promoted. Again, one of the details I like is it's a bit unclear, like, where are these people once they've won? Because they talk about how winning on this talent show gets you off the bike. You don't have to be on the bike anymore.
Yeah.
But there's no vision of where are these other people. They just live in TV land now, and they're singing for you or doing whatever. And so the notion of this as an escape is very interesting, and the mechanics of it with the judges being entertaining, I would bet there's a bunch of stuff in there that if I watched more of those shows, it would make me like the episode even more.
Mm.
But I felt totally engaged by it, without having probably the adequate background information. Although I'm assuming that the one guy is supposed to look like Simon Cowell. I do know what Simon Cowell looks like. And there's one guy on there like that they've got to be trying to be Simon Cowell.
He's the Simon Cowell figure. He even sits in the spot where Simon Cowell sits on those shows.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
So that's why. I didn't know they had spots. That's pretty funny. I would want to.
Yeah.
I'd want Jeff's in it.
Yeah. No, it was. I mean, I don't know how much you want to talk about the plot and the story. And so in many ways, that's not really necessary. I guess it's more the.
Well, I guess if you want, I'll try to do a quick summary of the rest of it, and then I have a couple points on the show. Unless there's something else you want to bring up now?
No, go ahead, please.
Okay. So the rest of what happens is basically our main character meets a girl, and he clearly has a crush on her, and he likes her, and she has a pretty singing voice, and he buys a ticket for her to go on this show. And it basically bankrupts him. He has no real credits left, just, you know, a couple hundred, and he paid $15 million for her to go on this show.
Mm-hmm.
And she's going up there to sing, and it's a new season of their talent show. And what happens is she goes on and she sings her song, but there's a new judge on the panel who runs the pornography channel that has been interrupting us all episode long with its advertisements. And it turns out that they don't think she's a good enough singer to be a professional singer, but the pornography guy wants her to be one of the girls on his channel. And this is also a callback. There is just this enormous amount of peer pressure from the crowd and from the judges, and she has also been drugged with this, again, sort of unspecified compliance drug before she's gone on the stage. So she's not fully in her right mind. She's in an incredibly difficult situation. And this is where they do mention that, you know, I can't believe you're wasting everybody's time and all of these credits. You know, who do you like, all of these people who are running the bikes, like, you need to be grateful to them and take this amazing opportunity that most people will never get.
Yeah.
And so she agrees and gets, like, disappears. You just, like, you don't really know where she goes. And in a terribly horrible, crushing scene, you see our main character later on in his room, now with no credits, and a pornography ad comes on, and it's a special ad that's going to show you the whole thing, and it is her like promotion and her first appearance on this pornography channel. And I've got to say, I mean, Black Mirror is a hard show to watch, and this is
he can't turn the ad off because he's got no credits left, and he can't shut his eyes. So he's been, and this is someone he cared for and tried to give an opportunity to, and now he's been forced to watch her sort of exploited. And
there are so many difficult scenes in Black Mirror that are very well done, but this one is really up there. It's like, oh man, you know, this is all his fault, and you really understand how empty his life is before he even met this girl, and he thought he was doing the best thing for her, and she is clearly drugged in the video that comes up on the advertising. Like, she's not really in her right mind, and they have her singing the song that she sung on stage, and it's like, it's hard to watch. It's so hard to watch.
Yeah, yeah.
And that actor, I don't know who that guy was, but this guy is just an amazing actor. I can't believe I haven't seen him in anything else. But he does a flip out scene where he ends up smashing some of the screens in his room, and it kind of ends with him on the ground crying, and some of the screens are smashed, but the ad is still going on in the background, and it's just, it is awful. But then the finale of the show is, he does have a shard of glass now from this broken screen, and they do a montage of him. A montage sounds so cheesy. It is, again, so well done in the show.
Yeah.
Like, a montage of him filled with hatred and rage, just cycling on the bike and buying nothing, and being on borderline starvation because he doesn't want to pay for any of the food, just saving up the 15 million credits to get on the show. And then he goes on the show, he gets there, he has this shard of glass in hidden it on himself, and when he gets on the show, he holds it to his neck, and again, in an amazing performance, because you've hardly heard this guy talk.
Yeah.
And then he gives this rage-filled, kind of incoherent monologue about how awful their whole society is, and how these judges are the people sitting on the top of the whole thing, and it's just absolutely terrible. And he's holding this shard of glass to his neck, you know, threatening to kill himself, and miss a beat, and the judges are going, "That was the most amazing outpouring of emotion we've ever seen. You know, we want you to be on our TV channel where you can talk about this kind of stuff, you know, twice a week live."
Yeah.
And again, it cuts, it's a little bit unclear what happens to him, but then the kind of closing scenes are, one of his friends is on the bike and watching his show where he's sitting in his room with the glass to his neck and giving a monologue about how terrible their whole society is.
Like, that's his shtick now. He does these cool rages with glass to his neck, and it's just like a commodity now.
When I was making notes, I thought there was a great line that one of the judges says to him, because they're like a little bit trying to figure out what this guy's about, and one of the judges says, "You know, you're a little out there, but that throat cutting thing, neat gimmick."
Yeah,
and it's so crushing, because it's like, it undermines everything that he's just done. Like, boy, that was a really great gimmick you had on the stage there with your with your blade. God, it's so awful. And then, but
he sells out great. That's the, in the end, he sells out. And like, it ends with him. We do see that he's now living in like a lovely place, and he just does his TV show twice.
This is one of the details that I missed the first time I watched it, and on the second watch through, I can't believe I missed it. But when he's broadcasting his show, it looks like he's in his old cell. But when the camera goes to him really recording the show, you can see that his cell is really just a tiny corner in his now huge white house.
Yeah.
Like, instead of everything being gray and black, he now lives in a much bigger house that is entirely white, that has a fake corner of his old cell in the center of the house where he records his show, and he holds his shard of glass to his neck during the show. And you can see that during the show, they're selling a virtual item for your doppel to hold on to, which is a shard of glass, so you can be just like our social critic.
Yeah.
And then the final scene is him going over to the wall and looking out over this vast scene of a beautiful forest. And one of the things I really like about that last shot is it is unclear as to whether or not he is looking out over real nature or whether or not these are just very good screens now that he's looking at. And it's what I love about that is it kind of undercuts the whole society they live in, because if he's looking out on a real mirror, you can see that the world is fine and this post-apocalyptic feeling that you've had the whole time is sort of a lie. But if he's looking out on, if he's looking on screens, well, he's in a cell, he's just in a bigger cell. Like, either way, it is awful. And that's why this episode is just such a crushing episode of television in every way. But I just thought it was amazingly done from start to finish. It is just so good.
Very good. I could watch it a few times. All the episodes in that series are good, but this one had a few extra things that I really liked.
Yeah.
Was there anything you didn't like?
I can honestly say that there is nothing about the episode that I didn't like.
It's good. Good review.
Watching it on the second time through, there were just a million details that I picked up on that I thought, man, this is just so good. Like, there's all these... There's a shot that maybe one of the judges, there's a middle judge, and there's some indications that, like, maybe she doesn't really like the society either. Like, she doesn't go along with it, but she's playing her role. Whereas the two guys on the either side, you can feel like, oh, they are just into it. And they are also the ones who push all the contestants to do something.
Yeah.
Like, there's just so many details that were great. But one of the things that I really appreciate with television or with movies is when they know what not to tell you. When they know what details to hint at, but without really explaining it. And one of the things that just happens in the background of this show that I thought was great is there's like an underclass of fat people in yellow outfits who are the janitors. And it's not exactly clear why, but one of the characters either gives up or is like fired from being on the bike, and he turns up later as one of the janitors, and he's like an overweight character on the show. And all of the janitors are overweight. And there's like no real explanation of what do these people, like, what is their role in society? You know, why are they all fat? And I think
because
really,
they're not cycling, I imagine.
Yeah, but there's a little line in there which I almost wonder if it's connected to these guys, because he talks about the main character makes a mention about the cheap food being really bad for you, and
dear.
I almost.